what their brains are like normally. So she has to give them like mathematical exercises to do to get their brains, the blood moving to other areas of their brain. All right? It's very interesting research. But she's come up with a formulation which I think is worth paying attention to. She says she believes very strongly now that there are three brain circuits that have to do with mating, with men and women getting together. The first and most primitive one is the sexual circuit. And she believes that this, this more ancient circuitry was in place so that we could propagate. And this is the same with other creatures. With sexual circuitry, a man can have many partners and pass his seed on. And this is, in evolutionary terms, this is something that is going to make us more successful as a species. And this is how it went for a very long time. And it was fine for a very long time. She believes it changed when we came down from the trees. And her hypothesis is that this was a problem for women with babies coming down from the trees. They have to hold on with one arm to their baby. They're vulnerable, all right? They need a man not just to give them a seed now, they need a man around for a while till this baby can walk and she can have both arms free. She needs protection for herself and her child. So she believes that this is when the romantic circuitry started to develop. With romantic circuitry, you get a very intense involvement, and you only want to be with one person, right? So this was a revolution. A very intense relationship where you only think about one person. And this enabled the man to want to be with his partner and to stay with that partner long enough that they became more or less able to stand on his own feet. Now, we continue to develop as a species in a way which no other species has matched. And that is, we have a huge potential, and we are the most unfinished creature at birth. We have, our brains continue to grow. Our brains aren't finished at birth. We have a flexible skull, it's still growing, and it grows and grows, and we have a way more potential than could have been imagined when we first came down from the trees. Human children started to require more and more longer-term care. We started to want to socialize them, to educate them. We started to create towns and societies. And it became more necessary for the parents to stay around for longer than just a couple of years. And romantic circuitry works, holds its strength for maybe up to 3 years. So we needed something more. And she believes that's when we started to develop the attachment circuitry. So we have attachment relationships which are long-term. So we have these three systems in our brain. And we all have all three of them. She says quite naturally, they're linked, all right? There are, for example, hormones which are stimulated when we have sexual orgasms that promote a feeling of romance, all right? And there are some also which stimulate attachment. So Helen Fisher, who is not a religious person, nevertheless says, if you're going to have a sexual relationship with somebody, watch out. Because because it may not be as simple as just sex, because there are hormones that are going to pump in your system which make you want to love that person and even stay with that person.
Isn't that different for men and women? Isn't it more so for women?
Probably more so for women. There's other factors. Definitely, if you just think from an evolutionary point of view, men are more likely to move into what I call a schizoid frame of reference to love. Okay? We're more able to separate the sexual stuff from the feeling stuff to the attachment stuff. All right? And actually, Helen Fisher points out that although these three circuits have connections, they can operate in all of us, males and females, they can operate separately. So it's very possible for one person to have a lot of different sexual partners, one partner that they're deeply in love with, and another partner that they're attached to. All right? So while there are connections, they are not written in stone. Okay? And this is a problem. It's a problem from the point of view of the need for attachment. Because our children benefit from having a mother and father who are together, who love each other and stay together. We have continued to need more and more long-term nurturing as a human creature. And it is continuing to increase, it seems. So you find children still being supported by parents when they're 18, 19, 20, 21. Sometimes, you know, in North America, coming back when they're 30, 40. It happens like this. We remain unfinished for a longer period of time. And psychologically speaking, it's very helpful if we have this support. If you look at our societies, the ones who have the most trouble in our societies are those whose parents haven't stayed together. They're much more likely to wind up in prison. They're much more likely to be poorer in education. They're much more likely to be unsuccessful in on occupation. So for the human creature in this modern world, having parents who love each other and stay together is very, very important. It's important for the children, and it's becoming clear all the time that it's also important for us. We have a need, a human need, to have a close, secure attachment to somebody else. When we have that, we are more healthy. Physically more healthy. Mentally more healthy. We are more satisfied, and our life works out better, just on the whole. These are statistics. So, a lot is pointing to the need for this long-term attachment. And to have that, what we want then is to have these circuits, the sexual, the romantic, and the attachment circuits, linked and integrated. And that is only partly helped by our physiology. Our physiology does not really require that bond and that integration. We need to do it somehow ourselves. We need to be able to think and choose in these ways. And this is pointing in a direction where, which is very interesting to me, because my work is in therapy, mostly working with couples. And early on in my work, I started in family therapy, and early on in my work, I discovered this phenomenon I would, one of the questions I would ask couples who came to me is, how did you meet? What attracted you to each other? What's your story? It's a fascinating question. And just hear story after story, oh, you know, this was the only person for me, and da 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 da. This is all romance, all right? It was exciting. Everyone, every single story, exciting. And this was all they ever wanted in the world, they realized, when they met their partner. Okay? But here they are in my office, and they're ready to scratch each other's eyes out. They're not happy. What happened? This is my question. What happened in these years that this couple, who were so romantic, so in love with each other, and now they can't stand each other, and they're having a hard time staying together, but maybe wanting to stay together because of their children, realizing, you know, if you're married and have children, you realize how painful it is for your children not to have both of you there. It's a horrible prospect for a parent. So, in those days, and I was one of them, people working with couples, therapists working with couples, were not being very successful. Divorce rates were already very high. More and more people were going to therapists when they ran